Circus begins with a quiet morning in a small town. And in the distance, you can hear the circus band approaching.
Gentlemen, hold your horses, the elephants are coming. Make way for the circus parade. Stay back, ladies and gentlemen, make room. Hold on to your children. And please don't try to feed the animals. It's a sure way to lose a few fingers. Circus wagons are quite large. I think I see them. Here they come. And it's the bandwagon! Gentlemen, right this way. Don't be afraid to step right up. Cotton candy, peanuts, get them right here while they're hot. Sir, have you ever seen a bearded lady? No? Well, now's your opportunity. Get them right here, souvenir programs. It's true, folks. This man right here breathes fire. Sir, you better put out that cigar. Ladies and gentlemen, your attention, please. Settle down and take your seats in our glorious big top and give your attention over to our wonderful circus band. Folks, we are very proud to present tonight's Center Ring Concert. The songs you will hear come from the very early days of the American Circus. They are very difficult to play, and we present them to you without the distraction of any circus acts or other performers. That means you, Drexel, wherever you are. Woo-hoo! There you go. Tonight, for your entertainment, the Center Ring Concert consists of the Boys of the Old Brigade, In Storm and Sunshine, and the Battle of Shiloh. We'll be right back. and gentlemen, and children of all ages, the circus is about to begin. The Big Top Circus presents the entrance and opening spectacle. The band will play Entry of the Gladiators, otherwise known as Thunder and Blazes. Those ferocious felines, those cantankerous cats, those lions, tigers, and
bears.
No, sorry, not that. Lions, tigers, and one brave dude, the lion tamer, right? The band will play March Ponderoso, Jungle Queen, and the Big Cage.
Thank you.
sets the pace of the show, and signals everyone in the big top and in the back lot, animals and performers, and the rouseabouts, where the program is, since no announcements are made. Everyone knows the show order, including the animals, and prepares equipment and props, and gets ready to go in line to enter the big top on their own cue. Now, the thing about the circus band is it sits face on, primarily because I think there was limited space, and they usually sat over the entrance into the big top where the acts came in under the bandstand. The bandmaster usually faces the rings to judge what changes need to be made, and the bandmaster uses hand signals. As you've seen me do, you probably never saw a band director in a concert doing that kind of stuff. But things are happening in the circus that need adjustments. Animals aren't in the right place. Accidents occur of some nature, equipment doesn't work, and so on. The bandmaster has to watch and make adjustments for that. And sometimes the band members don't follow those changes. Now, the kinds of music you find in the circus are marches, which are used primarily for the opening entry and the finale of the show, and in the circus parade. Then they have things called screamers, which are the fast marches. And then we have things called cage cleaners, which you just heard, a cage cleaner. And the purpose of that is that when you have, in this case, we had big cats in cages in the center of the big top, you've got to get those cats out of those cages and running through the line of cages back to where they belong in the back lot. That's why they're called cage cleaners. Not because there's anything in the cages to clean up. It's to clean the animals out of the cages themselves. Also, these cage cleaners are used whenever the rouseabouts need to take down rigging and nets and move heavier equipment around and replace props for the different acts. And there also are waltzes in the used in the circus, and usually these are for the beautiful acts, the slower acts like trapeze and tightrope walking. And finally, we have music that's appropriate to the spectacles of the circus. Every show has a spectacle or two. This one will.
There's not a bad seat in the house, ladies and gentlemen, as we will fill all three rings simultaneously with amazing feats of animal skill. Feast your eyes on these clever canines, these magnificent monkeys, and these pleasantly proficient ponies. The band will play Bravura.
Thank you.
you'll see some drawings made specifically for us concerning the raising of the big top. First, we have, of course, the red wagons delivering everything that's necessary for raising the big top. We have wagons with canvas, wagons full of stakes, wagons with long poles, and wagons with the luggage. Now, here's the materials that are necessary for putting up the big top. Rolls of canvas, long poles, wooden stakes, rope, manpower with those heavy sledges to pound in the stakes, and the elephants to raise the big top. Now, the first thing that happens is that the wagons place the rolls of canvas all around where the big top is going to be located. Then we roll out the canvas, and that's either done by men pushing these large rolls or elephants. The elephant gets his head down there and rolls it along. When the roll of canvas gets very low, he kicks it with his feet. The elephant seems to like to do that. Then with rope, we lace all the pieces of canvas together to form the tent. And in this one, we have three main poles. So this either could be a two-ring circus with the rings located between the poles, or it could be a five-ring circus if this were really a very large tent. And at different times, Great Circus of America, I think that was his name, and Ringling Brothers actually had five-ring shows. Now here's, obviously the tent is very high. You can't haul poles around that long. So what you do is you fit them together, run large bolts through them, and then you wrap them tightly with rope and create a very tall pole. So now we have the canvas laying on the ground, and we have placed a large steel ring at the bottom of the main pole. We've got a partial circle of stakes pounded in the ground that we're going to push that pole against, and we've got the main guy ropes located out to the side. Then we can pull on those guy ropes and raise the main pole, or we could use the elephants to pull it up, and then we stake down the guy ropes for the circus. Now we've got the thing that everyone has seen, the fellows pounding the stakes in all around the edge of the big top, and usually they have either a small person or a kid who works for the circus crawl in underneath and hold that stake. And usually there are four men pounding. Bam, 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 bam. And the kid's down in there holding that stake. And then once the big top is raised, and that's done by the team of elephants pulling on the ropes that just lift the canvas right up, then you have the intermediate poles inside, and they have a spike on one end, and they reach them up into grommets in the big top, and the elephants can pull on those secondary poles and straighten them up. So now we have the main guy wires, the guy ropes at the end, and all the intermediate poles placed, and then we have short 10-foot poles all the way around the periphery. And those have ropes going down to the stakes. And there is a canvas wall that hangs down from the tent at that time. So now we have erected the three main poles. And that ring that you saw before is shown here. And that's called the king ring. The canvas is attached to that. And that's what pulls the... by way of the ropes attached to it, pulls the tent up to the top. Now the rings date back. standard size, 42 feet in diameter. And the reason there has to be a standard size is that from year to year, acts are with one circus, and the next year they're with another circus. And so there's got to be some standardization so both performers and animals know what their working space is. This is very important, the standardization of the rings. Now, the rings themselves are made out of laminated pieces of heavy, heavy wood with a spike in one end and a hole in the other, and you fit them all together into a ring, and you run a rope all the way around, and with a winch, you tighten it up very tight, because as the animals are performing, they can kick the ring and dislodge it if it weren't fastened together very tightly. And the elephants certainly can do that. The horses do tend to accidentally kick the rings and dislodge them if they're not fastened on very tightly.
The band will now play Send In the Clowns. No, not you, Drexel. That's not the right. Oh, I'm sorry. The band will now play Tears of a Clown. No, that's some good Motown, though. Maybe this is it. The band will now play Face of a Clown. No, this sure ain't country up here, is it? Y'all enjoy Drexel while the band plays Prince of Decora.
And you have the sideshow performers. And you have the showgirls. So those are the girls who ride on the animals in the parade and in the entrance and grand entry of the circus and so on, and perform other functions in the circus to make it look pretty and soft. Now for the equipment and animals, we have show-owned equipment, and that is the uniforms of the musicians and the uniforms of the roustabouts who appear in the circus and in the circus parade. And you also have the costumes of the show girls. Now, the performers, they themselves must provide their own costumes. That's the clowns and the acts in the big dogs. The rigging, nets, and cages are also the property of the performers themselves. And the performers must supervise the setting up of that rigging and the taking down. That's why you see the famous lion tamer out there working right along with everybody else in the center of the big top, putting up the cages and taking them down. They belong to him, they're his responsibility, and his responsibility includes the tiger's escape. So that's why he has to be out there in charge of it. The props that are used in all the different acts belong to the performers themselves. And the performing animals themselves belong to the performers. In other words, you see horses in acts in the circus, they belong to the performer. You see any other animal, dogs and whatever, they belong to the performers themselves. And sometimes the performers also supply the vehicles that are used to transport all of that equipment and their animals.
Over in ring number one, expert riders perform on high school horses. And in ring number three, the riderless Liberty horses are expertly guided by a single trainer. The band will play Olympia Hippodrome March and a galop called simply Go.
Thank you.
say a few words about the back lot at the circus. Not very many people have an opportunity to get back there. They don't like visitors in the back lot. But you have tents in the back lot. You have the dining tent, the stable tent, and you have Clown Alley, which is the tent in which the clowns put on their costumes and their makeup. And typically, there's quite a few clowns in the circus, and they need a lot of space and a lot of time to get ready for the show. You also have, located more closely to the entrance, you have a menagerie tent and a sideshow tent. Now, you have wagons in the back lot. Red wagons are the freight and baggage wagons. But you also have a kitchen wagon, a generator wagon, a wagon or wagons for carpenters, painters, and blacksmiths. And you have a wardrobe wagon in which show itself is responsible for alterations and repairs and cleaning of the costumes and uniforms provided for those people employed directly by the circus. You have cage wagons in the back, and you have bunk wagons. Also, there are the wagons for poles, stakes, canvas, ropes, chairs, bleachers. That's all in the back. Now, you have some brightly painted wagons. They're not necessarily in the back. But you have the ticket and office wagon. You have concessions wagons. Now, these are all highly decorated. And then stored in the back, you have the parade wagons, which include the band wagon, cage wagons, and special wagons built for displays. Also, in back lot, you'll quite frequently find vehicles, both cars and trucks and campers and so on, that are owned by the performers themselves.
Typically, a new circus spectacle is developed every circus season, as the bandmaster was explaining. A spec, as it's called for short, is a lavish performance of literary or historical tales featuring as many of the performers and animals as possible. The first recorded spec was in 1796, indeed in the very first circus established in the United States, and its story was based on George Washington's suppression of the Whiskey Rebellion only 2 years prior. This evening's spectacle is based on the iconic westward expansion of these United States. So, ladies and gentlemen, the Wild West Spectacle! The band will play selected portions of the Light Cavalry Overture and the William Tell Overture.
Thank you.
to do the, what's called the flying squad. The advanced man moves ahead up of the circus by 2-4 weeks, and he receives a route card from management as to where the circus is going to be at any particular time. And his job is to put up the posters, arrange for it, arrange for feed, straw, and sawdust. You know, in the circus, the floor of the tent is made of sawdust. That's why the term the tan bark trail came from the use of sawdust in the big top itself. But straw is necessary for all the stable tents and so on. And he has to also arrange for food and water and permits and make sure the lot is properly prepared. Now, how many of you have driven along the road and seen something like this as you were driving along? Don't see it so much these days, but you used to, remember seeing that? Or sometimes they would look like this. I stole these from Cole Brothers. You see this sign? Sometimes they go like that, and then ultimately they look like this. These are the route markers. Because the circus travels on the road in convoys. When they see this, that means you're here, you're at the place. All those other route markers show left turns, right turns, bear right, and so on. Now, the reason why these route markers are necessary is that after the meal, before the final evening show, immediately the dining tent is taken down, packed up. That's the first unit to leave the circus. And then as the different acts perform, as they leave the big top, they're put right onto their wagons or loaded onto the train or put into trucks, and the circus moves in convoys. So when enough of these vehicles are already loaded, they go on the road, follow the route signs to the next location. And as the evening show proceeds, more and more the acts are loaded, animals, props, everything, until whenever the final spectacle is over, almost the whole circus is on the road, except for the big top. So, It's important that these route signs be in place, and because they're following them quite frequently at night. Now, in the old days, the circus didn't really move too far in to the next show place, so they could make it probably in a few hours. So all night long, they're traveling and they get to the new site. And when they get there, what do they find? They find the cook tent and the kitchen and the cook dining tent is already up and operating, and they have run a flag up the flagpole in front of the cook tent to indicate that food is ready. It's a very slick operation, and in fact, after some debacles that Pershing experienced in the Mexican War, they realized that logistics was a really big deal. And who knew logistics best? The circus. And so the circus is performed as consultants to the development of the logistics programs in the U.S. Army.
Please, folks, there's no need to panic. It's only a minor combustion. See? Here comes the fire wagon now. The band now plays, what else would you expect? Midnight Fire Alarm.
We'll be right back.
Mike. What day is it?
Hump Day.
That's right, it's Hump Day. And here they are, folks. The one hump dromedaries and the two hump camels. The band will play, get ready for it, the Caravan Club.
We want
western half of Pennsylvania, back and forth through all the counties, and down all the counties in the eastern part of Ohio. And by the time we got down to near Cincinnati, 6 weeks had gone by. We were coming up a couple of weeks before school start was supposed to start. I jumped on a Greyhound bus, and then a couple hours I was home. So that's how it happened. You have another question, Rexall?
Yes. Did they have Greyhounds back then?
And it ran on regular schedule.
Oh. Oh. Did you ever have to take water to all of those elephants?
That's a trick question. Because anyone who answers that question and says yes, you know they are lying.
Why?
Because you can't haul enough water to elephants. You take the elephants to the water.
That familiar barking sound isn't coming from domesticated pets, ladies and gentlemen. Feast your eyes and ears on our super set of seals, known around here as walking frogs. The band will play The Walking Frog and Blaze Away.
Thank you.
performers of all, including trapeze, flyers, and catchers, the Astounding Aerialists. The band will play a selection from Marinarella Overture, Wedding of the Winds, and the Thunderbolt Galop.
Thank you.
talk to you about a lot of different departments in the circus. First one being the wardrobe department, which I mentioned previously, creates the costumes and uniforms, and also the flags for the circus and the animal covers that are worn by the animals in the parade, in the entrance and finale of the Big Top show. The catering department is open 24 hours a day, donuts and coffee 24 hours a day. Put the flag up for meals. Now you might wonder, why don't you have a bugle player play to call people when the meals are ready? Two reasons. First, you'd have to go and find him. Secondly, you gotta pay him. Meals are served to the management and the stars, and everyone else goes through the buffet line. And the seating is separate also for the management and stars, and separate for the musicians and the Big Top performers, and for the showgirls, clowns, and sideshow performers. And the lowest on the totem pole is the laborers and the roustabouts. I know all about that. All right, now who is the management? Management is the owner, the manager, and his staff, and obviously the people who handle the money. There's a lot of cash used to be hanging around in circuses. That was important. And another guy was part of management called the fixer. That's who he was, the lawyer. All right, the stars are the star performers, the ringmaster, and the bandmaster. The musicians and the Big Top performers and the sideshow performers and the showgirls all were sort of in the same group. But the sideshow performers and the showgirls had very special situations in the circus. If a roustabout or a laborer was ever heard speaking to a showgirl and not calling her Miss Susie and Miss Janie and Miss Helen, you were in trouble. But if you ever spoke disrespectfully to the sideshow performers, previously known as the freak show, you really were in trouble. Those people had a very special place in the circus. You did not insult them. They were performers and they wanted to be considered as performers. Now the laborers, or the roustabouts, that included the canvas gang, truck or wagon drivers, animal handlers, fellows that worked in the stables, and the technicians, electrical, painting, and carpentry. And circus carried its own electrical system along with the generator and all the cables and light.
Is that better? You guys are going to give me in trouble with Jim. All the way from the steppes of Eastern Europe and Asia, these are the finest horsemen in the world today, our very own Cossack Trick Riders. The band will play excerpts from Hungarian Dance Number 5 and from Hungarian Dance Number 6. we have a very special treat for you this evening. Her voluptuous voice has entranced audiences all around the world, including such entertainment meccas as Holly Springs, Lizard Lick, and actually, Kalamazoo. Tonight she will sing I've Made Plans for the Summer by the ever-popular John Philip Sousa. Mr. Sousa didn't write much music for the circus, but this tune was very popular in the early circus days. You will also hear a medley of other popular tunes of the day called Old Timers Waltz. It gives me great pleasure to present, for your listening pleasure, Ms. Jenny Walker from California.
A man that I met who was handsome.
happened were wild animals loose or fighting. And in Hartford, Connecticut, there was a fire. They used flammable materials to waterproof the tents in those days. Big Top caught fire and hundreds of people were injured and killed. Another disaster was could have been from many train wrecks that happened and accidents and wrecks that happened in the switching yards. But a particular one is applicable to us here locally in that it happened to the Buffalo Bill Wild West Show that was heading north from Charlotte in three separate trains, the convoy concept again. And the first train had a head-on collision with a southbound train that had ignored track signals. As if that wasn't bad enough, not very much later, the second train crashed into that whole mess. Now, there were animals, people, dead, dying, wandering around. And the third train came upon them that managed to stop in time. That was a huge disaster. Destroyed Buffalo Bill Wild West Show. Never came back. In Canton, Ohio, there was an accident in that the main street in Canton goes down under a railroad overpass. And someone did not measure the height of that overpass correctly. The bandwagon is usually the tallest wagon in the circus, and it's got the band musicians on top. When that, of course, was pulled by six horses, they couldn't get it stopped when the driver saw what was going to happen, and it just smooshed the musicians on the top of the bandwagon. Very bad. Now, Carolyn and I happened to be present over in Dorton Arena when the human cannonball completely missed his safety net and landed in the audience. Now, when a disaster occurs in the Big Top, a specific tune is played, and when anyone in the back lot or lined up to come in or in the Big Top hears this, they know that emergency or disaster has occurred because the stars and stripes can be heard all over the circus lot.
Fire! Fire!
Folks, please walk carefully to the nearest exit. You'll be
fire!
Okay. That's fine. That's right. Help. Take care of your children. Make sure everybody gets out safely. Fire brigade is on its way. There's no need to panic. Drexel, there's no need to panic.
Sees the animals that belong to the performers. There are lots of other animals that belong to the show. Draft horses, for example, pull the wagons and help load the trains with those wagons. There were non-performing animals that were in the menagerie. They belonged to the big top show. Hippos, giraffes, alligators, crocodiles, big snakes. But the one that is the most popular is the elephant. And the elephants are the only animals in the circus that are both workers and performers. Now, all these animals I've mentioned belong to the circus. The elephants belong to the circus. They don't belong to any performer. There were a few African elephants that almost all were Asian elephants. There were a few males also, but mostly they were all females. And all the elephants, regardless of what sex they were called bulls. Elephants were handy doing work because they could push wagons. You didn't have to get a team of horses, bring them over, hook them up to the wagon, and move it. You could just call over an elephant. He'd lean his head against it and push it 5 or 10 feet, whatever adjustment needed to be made. They could unroll the canvas. They were the ones who pulled the heavy big top up. They could lift heavy objects like the sections of the ring and straighten the tent poles. Now, the elephants, when they were in the back lot and heard the music that indicated it was not long before they were going to perform, they would line up themselves. They liked to perform. They would line up in order. And if some one elephant was out of order, the old matriarch came back and settled that. So they knew their place, and they obeyed the boss. Now, when they lined up, the younger elephants held the tails of the older elephants in front of them. But the little baby elephants ran alongside their mothers. So when their time to enter came, they were already lined up in the entranceway. No drivers, no riders, no attendants. The handlers would race out into the big top and stand by the rings where the elephants were to perform. But once the elephants heard their music, as we played earlier on, they just came out pell-mell, running, top speed. Now picture this, a whole bunch of elephants in a line, the big elephants and the younger ones holding tails behind them, and the little babies running alongside. At one time, Ringling Brothers had what they called the Congress of Elephants. 100 elephants, if you can imagine such a thing. And those elephants run out and around the hippodrome track until they get to the place where their handlers tell them, get in the ring here and start doing your thing. Now, the elephants really did enjoy performing, and they liked their work, too. They seemed to like their work, also. And when there was an emergency, or you needed to get the elephants to do something special to get them to leave, usually because they wouldn't stop performing, you shouted out, tails, tails, tails. And they knew, grab the tail of the person ahead of you. And that way you could get them all lined up and tell the matriarch, time to go.
Here's what you've all been waiting for, those ponderously plodding pachyderms. Ladies and gentlemen, the elephants. The band will play another excerpt from Marinarella Overture, In a Persian Market, and, surprise, surprise, Parade of the Elephants.
Thank you.
Once again, in the highest reaches of the Big Top, please direct your attention to our death-defying experts in balance and bravery, our artists on the tight wire. But wait, there's more. Closer to terra firma, feast your eyes on the daredevils on the slack wire. The band will play King of Terror and Rolling Thunder. Attention and try to keep up with our amazing acrobats, our terrific tumblers, and our jammin' jugglers as the band plays Zacatecas and El Relicario.
Thank you.
attended by Kaylin Waddell, back there in the control tower. We have on top of this fantastic light and video show, and they're also responsible for the stage and the stage and the audio in the theater. Great job. To the art staff here at Cary Art Center for the posters and the drawings and the photos and the slideshow. A great job was done by them. And also to the administrative staff and the volunteers who have helped out tonight. Also to Sarah Preston, who is the manager of this fantastic facility that we have here at the Cary Art Center. Also, Lyman Collins, who is the supervisor of the Tom Cary Cultural Arts Division, who, when I approached with this idea, jumped on it right away and helped me keep that big ball going the whole time. Wish he could have helped me with the direction of the band. I'd like to give to the Cary Tom Band a donation for all the resources that they have provided. All the resources from the Cary Tom Band. I really, really appreciate it. I have a donation which I'll give to Stuart Holloman, who is the director of the Cary Tom Band. Very special gift for Scott Stupak, who, when I mentioned the matter of the music library, he jumped right on it. He didn't volunteer. He jumped right on it and created this fantastic library of music for this program. Let's make music!
show, ladies and gentlemen, the grandest collection of talent, of bravery, and of artistry ever assembled. Here they are again for the grand finale. The band will take us out with Barnum and Bailey's Favorite.